All right, now let's work on that introduction, top of the page. You'll notice you'll use your third finger on the third string in the fourth space, and you're going to play it along with the B string open. And we wind up with the E chord. Now the technique here is in the picking, or the strumming of the two strings. So I am going to play it slowly the first time, then I'm going to pick up the tempo the second time so that you can practice one and then segue into the other and then be ready for the real thing. All right? Now, before we take up the playing of chords, I have to talk to you about a very important subject. This has to do with tuning the guitar without the aid of another instrument, such as a pitch pipe, another guitar, or these recordings. And the reason it's important, say that someday in the future you're playing a job and you can't get your guitar in tune and someone has to tune it for you. This can be very embarrassing. Now, on the bottom of page 7, this shows a method of tuning it without the aid of another instrument. Now you place your third finger on the sixth string in the fifth space. When you sound that string, it will sound exactly like the A string or the next one over, the fifth string. If it doesn't, you have to adjust it. Then you do the same thing with the A string, the D string. Now notice on the fourth diagram over, you're in the fourth space, not the fifth space, but the fourth space. Now when you think you have the guitar tuned, you play the G chord. This will tell you if all the strings are in tune with the chord. If they're not, then you have to start the process all over. But it's very important that you learn to tune the guitar with this method. Now, it's very important that you read this page carefully about your picking technique and about the different methods of tuning and how to stay out of trouble learning to tune the guitar. Now, about the study of chords, I can truthfully say that I do not know of a good guitar player who plays good single-string lead melody that doesn't know his chords. I know that playing single-string lead melody is like being a quarterback in a football game. It's a lot of fun, but you'll never play any good single-string lead melody unless you know your chords. Now let's look on page 15, the E chord on the bottom of the page. Now the E chord is not a difficult chord, and the main thing about any chord is to make sure that your fingers, your hand, and thumb are placed properly on the fingerboard and on the neck. Let's take a look at the E chord. You'll notice we have three strings that we play open, and you'll notice how my second and third finger are placed on the fourth and fifth string. Now the main thing about this chord is to make sure that your first finger is arched so it won't touch the second and the first string. And number two, make sure that your fingers, when you place them on the strings, are in the middle of the space. If you have them on top of the frets, it's going to make a buzzy sound. Now let's take a look at E7th. E7th is the same as E, except you place your little pinky, your fourth finger, on the second string. Now this is not going to come easy, but make sure again that the fourth finger is arched so it won't touch the first string. Now, A7th chord is probably the easiest of them all. You have four strings that you play open. The only thing that you have to watch is so that when you place your second and third finger down on the two strings, that you give the strings clearance that are to be played open. Now, let's take a look at B7th. Now, this is going to be the most difficult chord. And if you'll take a look at my thumb, you'll notice it points almost at my face, or if you're holding the chord, your thumb will point almost to your face. That's so that you can place your second, third, and fourth finger right across space number two. Now, there's one thing about B7th. That is a fact. You'll notice where my second finger is on the fifth string in the second space. You can just move that second finger over on the sixth string in the same space, and it'll sound like this. Now this is the way I show it in a photograph. You can almost not tell the difference. This is the way it's shown. Now, if I move my finger over on the sixth string, it'll sound like this. It'll give it a little more body. Now I'm going to alternate with my second finger between the fifth and the sixth string, and here's the way it'll sound. You see? So you can play either one of them. Now make sure that your fingers are on the right strings, that you give the strings clearance that are to be played open, and also make sure that you're in the right space. Because if you're not in the right space, the whole chord is shut. You see? All right, I'm going to play each one of these chords 8 beats each. And I'm going to go from left to right. And I want you to practice these chords and then try to play them along with me. 8 beats each. Now here we go. Now, an excellent idea would be to practice those chords, 8 beats each, like we just did, every time you have a practice session. Then, when you get the left hand under control so that you can play these chords, then move into the slow version. Now, do what I suggested before. Play one chorus of melody, the next chorus with chords, and work on that right hand. Now, this is where the intrinsic quality comes, with the drive, the beat, the soul, or whatever kind of music you're playing. And one thing I want you to remember is this. If you ever develop the reputation for being a good, fine rhythm guitar man, you've got something to be proud of, because they're hard to find. I'm talking about a rhythm guitar man who can drive a rhythm section right through the wall. Now, I think it would be a good idea to listen to record number 2. However, I believe your progress would be better if you learned to play record number 1 real well before you started learning to play the music on number 2. So I'll see you on number 2 record.